Good afternoon. On behalf of Brite Divinity School, my name is Carrie Day, the director of the Black Church Studies program. And of course, I want to welcome you to this very important event, Turning Tables, taking a look at Ferguson and Forney, and most importantly, thinking through and developing Christian strategies in terms of resisting forms of racialized violence. So before we move any further, at this time, I want to invite the Reverend Andre Gardner to come up and offer an introductory prayer, who is also a Brite alumnus.
Let us pray. God, our creator, God, our mother, God, our father, God of our weary years, God of our private and public tears, thou who has brought us thus far along the way. We gather here this afternoon in your presence to say thank you. Thank you that despite the situation, circumstance, conflict, your love is always present and your grace still abounds. God, we speak your power, presence, and provision into communities across our nation that are infested with the disease of racialized violence. God, we ask for justice, not justice that lifts the blindfold and makes decisions on the basis of race, class, gender, or sexual orientation, but God, we seek your justice. Justice that says that when you have done it unto the least of these, you've done it also unto me. Justice, as Amos would attest, that runs down like water with righteousness flowing like a mighty stream. Justice that will flow from Ferguson to Forney, from Florida, from Cleveland to Chicago, from Oakland to Oak Cliff. God, lead us, guide us, direct us, and protect us in this moment poised with potential and possibility. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
At this time, I'd like to invite President Newell Williams to come up and just give some brief remarks or words greeting the audience on today.
Well, I'm pleased to have an opportunity to add a word of welcome to you as we begin what I think will be a very important encounter together. And I give thanks for the gracious offer of prayer and for the gifts that you have requested. May it be so. We are fortunate that we have a person of Carrie Day's gifts in our community who is alert to the world around us and alert to God's Spirit working through the churches and in our larger society. And I want to thank you in particular for having arranged for this day, and thank each of you for being here.
So I wanted to say a little bit about the purpose, of course, of why we have gathered and what I hope will be not only an insightful and fulfilling session together, a way for you to walk away with tools, not only in terms of ideas and concepts, but practices and actual movements that you can join and collaborate with in addressing forms of racialized violence. There was a particular reason why I named this particular event Turning Tables in terms of resisting violence, all forms of racialized violence. Of course, we know that according to Matthew 21 and 12, that Jesus goes into the temple and turns over the tables of the money changers. And part of what we can gather from this particular passage is that Jesus does not necessarily see righteous anger as antithetical to a politics of love and justice. That righteous anger says something about systems and something about structures that not only produce injustices, but produce radical evil. I can imagine that for Jesus, what he did not want is he did not want these money changers and for those that saw these money changers to simply have apathy and with indifference think that they could do nothing, but rather that they could collectively come together and do something, really calling out the fact that exploitation is never okay. So in line with that, it is the Black Church Studies Program and Brite broadly, our belief that we are called to be radical preachers, radical thinkers, in much of the same way as Jesus. But I do want to say this. I think it's important for us not to read Jesus outside of the context of his mother Mary. If it wasn't for the women, that's a common statement within the Black church, that Mary, you know, we meet Mary in Luke 1. She is a revolutionary character who has the audacity to say that, God, I expect that you, and I'm paraphrasing, that you will bring low the thrones of those in power, and you will come to the rescue of the humble and the poor. And so I think what's important is, as we think collectively about what we are called to do in terms of our Christian witness, that we not only remember the witness of Jesus, but we remember the witness of Jesus' mother, Mary. So with that being said, two aims that I hope we can think and talk together with on today. The first one, as it relates to this session, this teaching, is that you might understand why responding to racialized violence is central to the Christian witness. Of course, we're going to talk, the two presenters today will talk about that this particular event, Ferguson and even Forney, is set within a much larger historical narrative about forms of racialized violence in the United States. But the question still remains, why? What is it about scripture, about tradition, about hearing in the sermonic moment that causes us to see this type of anti-Black racist activism not as peripheral to our Christian witness, but as central to our Christian witness? And then secondly, that we would understand, and this is really personal, how you might understand, how you can begin to dialogue in your own communities. I received emails not only here, but also want to welcome those that are watching online through live streaming. And many people that emailed me said, I just don't have the tools. I'm not familiar with the concepts. And for even for some that do know some of the theories, that are familiar with some of the concepts, they're still unsure on how to begin conversations within their community in relationship to forms of racialized violence. And so through this event, we hope that you will walk away tooled, beginning conversations within your communities, and most importantly, being able to take action. I'm going to come back up at the end, and I am going to talk a bit about something we have provided out in the lobby area at the table, teach-in resources that includes a beginning reading list, as well as some top movements that I think all of us could certainly support, movements that really focus on ending forms of racialized violence. And I'm very excited that one of our presenters today, the Reverend Dr. Frederick Haynes, is chair of one of the movements that are noted on the list, and that is the Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference. So with that being said, I want to now move to introducing our first presenter, the Dr. Reverend Will Gaffney. Dr. Gaffney, we're so excited about Dr. Gaffney being with us here at Brite. It is her first year. She is the Associate Professor of Hebrew Bible at Brite. She has published numerous books, numerous articles. One particular text that had a real impact on me as I was moving through my PhD studies, and that was Daughters of Miriam, Prophets in Ancient Israel. She's also been the editor of The People's Bible and The People Companion to the Bible. These two amazing books. I also want to say that she is not only a biblical scholar, a seminary professor, an Episcopal priest who does speak to the Black church as well, but she is a public intellectual. Many know her for her amazing public theological critiques as it relates to the History Channel and many of the movies that have come across over the last 2 or 3 years. But beyond that, she really adds an amazing dimension in terms of critical discourse to biblical studies nationwide. I also want to note that much of her work surrounds feminist, womanist, post-colonial, and queer methodologies as a way to foreground transgressive and subversive readings of the text. And so we are excited about having her today, knowing that we are going to learn from her. So right now, we welcome Dr. Will Gaffney.
afternoon. Turning tables and snatching wigs, a biblical response to Ferguson and Forney. Hashtag biblical justice. The events in Ferguson and Forney have made more visible to more people the divisions that many of us have known are present in our society for a long time. This time of heightened visibility offers for us an opportunity for sustained response across our subdivisions and invites reflection on some recurring and enduring patterns and the potential for their disruption and transformation. The response evoked by the title for today's teachings, Turning Tables, is a holy, holy, prophetic, kinetic, theologically justifiably violent, disruptive response to state-sanctioned violence against historically subjugated peoples. A modern-day corollary to turning tables is snatching wigs, the rhetorical practice of exposing that which poseurs and perpetrators want to keep hidden under the veneer of respectability. Today, I am snatching the wig of the white supremacist infrastructure of institutional America, including and particularly the framework of policing, citizenship, and the institutional church, including the patriarchy with which it colludes. But perhaps it is not I, but God through the scriptures, who is the real wig snatcher. Now, because I'm a biblical scholar and a priest, and because I'm a preacher who learned my craft in the black community, I look to the scriptures of Jesus, the Hebrew scriptures, for a word in response to the blood of black women and men crying out from the ground, and even their own homes, crying out from the asphalt, crying out from the streets, crying out from the sidewalk, crying out from the pavement, where some of their bodies have been left to lay in disrespect for hours upon hours. The word I hear in and from the scriptures is mishpat, justice. The root shafat is also the root of the verb that means to judge and provides the vocabulary for the judges themselves. Shofta and shofet, women and men who do the work of justice and the judgments, mishpatim, that they render. In the Hebrew Bible, judges are not so much those who judge, but those who render justice. Therefore, making unjust judgments is antithetical to biblical notions of justice. Biblical justice means to execute justice according to the merits of the case, to defend the rights of the people, plead the cause of the one who has been done injury, and vindicate and deliver the wrongly accused. We could use more than a little biblical justice. In Ferguson, Forney, and every other state and city in America. As I reflected upon what the Bible has to say to the long-standing experiences of black and brown people being over-policed, even to the point of death, that have so recently been exposed to the wider American and global publics, I look to Torah passages that speak of there being one law, one Torah, one rule for citizens and aliens, the strangers, immigrants, and foreigners in our midst. A biblical call to justice in the community looks like Deuteronomy 1:16. Listen to the members of your community and judge rightly, righteously, between one person and another, whether citizen or resident alien, that is, or an immigrant. The text makes clear that you cannot do justice for a person or people if you will not listen to them, hear their charges, hear and heed and act on their complaint, righteously, justly. Young black men have told us for decades that they have been targeted by the police for walking and driving while black. And some of us sisters have too. Black folk of all ages and genders and expressions of those genders have told our white colleagues, neighbors, friends, and church members that we are always followed in stores for shopping while black, only to be disbelieved and, in the cases of our sons and brothers, questioned. What were they doing? What were they wearing? Why the hell does that matter? Wearing a suit will not save you if you are black like me. Having a PhD will not save me or you. The thin veneer of respectability is a wig that needs to be snatched. The text in Deuteronomy says, if you are going to do justice, you need to start by listening. Can you hear us now, white America? Are you only listening because some young folk made a strategic decision, Dr. Haynes, to shout in the only language white America speaks with ease, financial loss and property destruction? Maybe your wig is blocking your ears. Will you hear us now? And for how long? The text says, listen. We have been telling our stories to those who would and who would not hear, and therefore do not seek to do justice on our behalf, with very few exceptions, for more than the 400 plus years that we have been here. But now we are amplifying our voices with using social media, and suddenly the mainstream media, America, and the rest of the world is looking at us for now. But one day, Ferguson is going to stop being fashionable. In fact, it's no longer leading the news cycle. That's why the rallying cry for so many of us is hashtag stay woke. The irony is not lost on me that the Torah in Deuteronomy 1:16 is concerned about making sure that resident aliens or immigrants receive the same treatment under the law as citizens, even though they are not citizens, Governor Perry, while assuming that all citizens are in fact receiving the same treatment under the law. That's why Exodus 12:49 also records, there shall be one law for the native and for the alien, the immigrant who resides among you. And Leviticus 24:22 demands, you shall have one law for the alien, the immigrant, and for the citizen, for I am the Holy One, your God. One of the questions that systemic police mistreatment of African Americans raises is whether we are even perceived as citizens of the United States of America and entitled to its protections under the law. Time and time again, the answer is clearly no. Police misconduct, all too often backed by judicial misconduct, makes it clear that we are not entitled to the dignity, respect, rule of law, or the rights of any other citizen to drive, to shop, to walk, to live or just be in certain neighborhoods, to transgress and survive that transgression, or exist and simply be and breathe. The fact is, the rules of citizenship in this country were never intended to apply to us. And even after amending our Constitution and calling for the enforcement of our right to vote and other civil and human rights, we are still struggling to have our basic rights to life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness, freedom to assemble, and freedom of speech respected and enforced. even though it stems from the Iron Age. Texts like Deuteronomy 1:16 simply can't imagine that all citizens are not treated the same. But we can. We could use that bit of Iron Age theology in this continuing or perhaps second civil rights era. Since our citizenship has been affirmed by every court in the land, in spite of continuing efforts to erode our voting rights and undermine compensatory programs like affirmative action that minimally address the disparate financial and social impact generated by the centuries of intentional, systematic, structural inequality, then we must demand the justice that the scriptures call for. Not because America is a Christian nation founded on Christian principles, it really isn't, or even because some of the framers of our nation were influenced by their own Christian beliefs, they were, yet since Christianity is not and should not be the law of the land, and because structural racialized violence affects Muslims, Sikhs, Buddhists, atheists, and Hindus, anybody with black or brown skin, we are ethically bound to insist on justice for ourselves and for our children and for other people's children, for all our sister and brother citizens, and those among us who are not citizens, immigrants, and aliens. In order to secure the mishpat, the justice that is our fundamental right as human beings, as Americans, and from the perspective of the scriptures, as God-breathed, sun-kissed, handcrafted bearers of the divine image, we must challenge the police, prosecutors, judiciary, and legislators to craft and apply the law with justice, judging rightly, righteously. We must hold them accountable when they fail. We must not accept their failure, but persist in challenging and correcting them for their own good, our good, and the good of our common society. In order to do this work, we must be radical. We must get to the radix, the root of the disdain for black and brown bodies in this country and more generally in the global experience. It is very clear to me, and not just me, that the basic humanity of black folk is still contested in these here United States. And as a result, our citizenship and constitutional protections are annulled in practice. Even in religious contexts, in which the common confession is that to be human is to be made in the image of God, black and brown folk are treated as though we are the children of a lesser God, and less than human, fundamentally unequal. For if we are the image of God with all of our radiant blackness, then the God whose image we reflect is not antithetical to or incidental to our blackness, but our blackness is part and parcel of the God whose image we faithfully reflect. Yes. This is also true of our womanity. And some folk are having a hard time recognizing God in woman flesh and are slapping the shit and beating the hell out of her as though she were not divine. And when radiant blackness and God-birthing, God-breathed womanity intersect, then our bodies are also lying in those streets with our brothers and sons, and our blood is crying out for the same justice, the same mishpat. Yet the white church as an institution has failed to recognize, let alone insist on the divinity of black bodies, just as patriarchy including black and brown skin patriarchy, has failed to recognize or insist upon the divinity of female bodies, gay bodies, trans bodies, or even some heterosexual male bodies if their performance of masculinity is not cartoonish enough. There is, however, no time like the present. Listen to the members of your community and judge rightly, righteously between one person and another, whether citizen or resident alien. The concern for relating rightly, justly to members of the community pervades the scriptures just as the message of love for neighbor pervades the canons of scriptures, the singular canon of the Jewish Bible and the multiple canons of the Christian Bibles. Jesus famously illustrated the answer to the question, just who is my neighbor anyway, with the parable of the Good Samaritan. The Bible is also replete with texts demonizing, marginalizing those who have been configured as other, as enemies. Slavery, rape, incest, murder are all biblical themes, as is violence in the name of God. And it is to those passages that white America has turned historically, even and especially in the church, to deal with black folk throughout the African diaspora, but particularly more often than not in these disunited states. We ought not be surprised that Iron Age theologians, seeing God at work in their context, experienced a God who was as biased as they were. We could and have here in the United States and throughout the Western world based our treatment of other people on the parts of the Bible that reinforce privileged self-perceptions of our own uniqueness and chosenness while subjugating others to perpetual subordination. We've been there and done that. Now it's time to move on. I contend that the Bible endures as scripture, the source of revelation and transformation in spite of the texts that reify hierarchy, patriarchy, and religious violence. Rather, visions of peace, reconciliation, and kinship across borders transcended the imaginations of Iron Age warlords and those in our own time. And that is why scripture endures as revelatory and revolutionary. One of those texts for me is Isaiah 19. Assyria is the dominant world power at the time the first 39 chapters of Isaiah are written. They made their bones on the backs of the previous Egyptian empire. Then they moved on to the smaller states, including Israel. Israel had broken itself into two pieces by this time. The northern monarchy, still called Israel, and the southern monarchy, Judah, where the temple stood and from which Isaiah wrote. In Isaiah's lifetime, the Assyrians came and devastated, decimated, and destroyed the northern monarchy. The king was imprisoned, the people were exiled, the capital city, Samaria, was repopulated with foreigners, who intermarried with the poorest of the poor left behind. Those people were considered so worthless, they weren't worth the cost of deporting. And that multicultural assemblage of people, their descendants became known as the Samaritans in the New Testament, which is why they were so despised. Isaiah is writing at a time when the word Israel only refers to the people of Judah and a few refugees from Benjamin and Simeon. They are 9.5 tribes short of a full deck. They were subject to the Assyrians, who savaged their little kingdom, hanging people on sharpened poles, cutting their heads and limbs off. Does this sound familiar? Even peeling their skin off and making images of that. Judah was paying rent on its throne, even ripping the gold off the temple doors to keep them at bay. And now, here comes Egypt back again. Egypt is more than a distant memory, an ancestral campfire ghost story. They are gathering once again. Egypt of ancient memory had enslaved and oppressed the Israelites for 400 long years, and now they are on the move and headed right towards Israel. While the Egyptians had been previously beat back by the Assyrians, they had reconstituted themselves under new leadership from the south. The 25th dynasty to rule Egypt was a Nubian or Kushite dynasty that moved up from Central Africa to the thrones of Egypt. And now Egypt had a new strategy for world domination. Sweet talk. Judah, you should be a free and independent nation. Don't let those Assyrians push you around. Push back. We got your back, way back. Judah knew that Egypt had just bailed on the Philistines in their ill-fated rebellion against Assyria. And now they are trying to set Judah up in a knuckle sandwich. Egypt on the west and Assyria on the east. The Egyptians, though an African people, have been forever read by black folk, especially those of us descended from American chattel slavery, as slaveholders. Our ancestors used to say, all my skin folk ain't my kinfolk, just as all the police who brutalize us are not white. However, today, most Egyptians do not identify themselves as black or even African. They're descended from the Arabs who conquered Egypt 600 years after the time of Christ. Now, the descendants of the Assyrians include the Syrians, who are simultaneously being slaughtered by their own government, mounting an armed resistance with help from any and everybody, including the United States, and barbarians, some of whom are also descended from the Assyrians, going around beheading and crucifying folk in the name of an Islam they neither comprehend nor follow. The footprint of the ancient Assyrian Empire includes the Iraqis, with whom we have just finished being at war, also under threat from the barbarians, and the Turks, who we keep hoping will put some skin in the game since this is their neighborhood. Syria, Iraq, and Turkey all have some Assyrian heritage. And when I read this piece of Isaiah, I see and hear their names as I envision the revolutionary and transformational reconciliation and restoration Isaiah envisioned. Isaiah's prophecy of a radical peace in the Middle East is what gives me hope we can transform our culture of policing, but the pervasive racism infecting our American dream is the original sin of the colonies and their descendants. Isaiah's context is key. Egypt and Assyria are real and present lethal dangers. They have raped, killed, enslaved, and subjugated his people for centuries. Yet his vision is that all of those now Arab and Muslim nations, Egypt, Syria, Iraq, and Turkey, will join with Israel and be blessed together by God to be recognized as the children of God together. That's right. I'm saying right relations between America and her black and brown citizens is as likely as peace in the Middle East. For some, that might be a statement of impossibility. But I believe in a God who specializes in the impossible, not to mention the unpopular. And so did Isaiah. This is what he records in 19, 24, and 25. One day, Israel will be third with Egypt and Assyria, a blessing in the center of the earth, whom God, the commander of angel armies, has blessed, saying, blessed be Egypt, my people, and blessed be Assyria, Iraq, Syria, and Turkey, the work of my hands, and Israel, my heritage. One day things will be different. That has been the hope and promise of our ancestors from the first day Africans set foot on this double continent, more than 460 years ago until the present moment. One day. One such day was the 20th of January when Barack Obama, the 44th president of the United States of America, was sworn into office. This day was a dream for some, previously only a fantasy for others. Yet for more, It was a nightmare, and in response, we have seen racism crawl out of the shadows once again, including at the highest levels of government. When I hear Isaiah preaching that in God's sight, the Egyptians who enslaved and oppressed the Israelites and the Assyrians who essentially wiped out 9.5 tribes of the Israelites were on the same footing with his God as were his own people, this is what gives me hope for transformation and reconciliation. The history of black folk and white folk in this country, the legacies of slavery, Jim and Jane Crow, the new Jim Crow, private prison industrial complex, are not as deeply rooted as the Arab-Israeli conflict to which Isaiah saw an end in his visions. I contend that we shouldn't have to wait that long. As Americans, justice is in our hands. We vote for our officials. That's one way we make sure they listen to us. And when they don't, we take to the streets, turning tables, even if they call it looting. We use our voice and we use our vote to insist on justice. We must raise our voice as loud as necessary to help them hear and remove any and all impediments in the way, snatching wigs whenever and wherever necessary. One day things will be different, but it won't be just because of an act of God. It will be because of what we do with the breath of God in our bodies, turning tables and snatching wigs.
At this time, we wanted to invite community conversation in terms of question and answer with Dr. Daphne. So we have a mic. Paul, there is a mic, I believe, right behind you. If you could, thank you, charge with being on that side with the mic, and I will be on this side. So please, we invite you. A time for questions, thoughts, reflections.
Hello, my name's Robin. I have a question. This is very timely for me. I was just talking to a good friend of mine last night, and we were on the discussion of Ferguson. Bottom line, she was like, I'm tired of seeing black folks turning tables, snatching wigs, only for a moment. We don't turn tables and snatch wigs when it comes to black-on-black crime. How do I address that? I was at a loss for the teaching tools to kind of address that. This will be here just for a moment, and then, like you said, Ferguson is already on the back burners as far as the news cycle, and we do this all the time. We gonna march on certain occasions, but not every injustice there is.
So I would say there are a couple dimensions to that. One is reality, and one is perceived reality, right? So we can never make our determination on what the folk are doing based on what we see in the media. Because the fact is, none of us know what all the black folk in this nation are doing. There are soldiers and activists on the front lines who have been on the front lines since Reconstruction, I'm talking in terms of movements, and then people who are living from before the classical beginning of the civil rights era. So the first question is not even about what anybody else is doing, but what are you doing, right?
I did say that to her.
Yeah.
And her response was, I said, okay, if we're not doing everything, then what you gonna do about it?
Right.
And that was really, it failed.
Right. So, I mean, this is a shut up or put up moment, right? So, as Dr. Day has said, we are identifying the agencies and communities that are doing this work, so no one has that excuse. So even if nobody you know is doing a mother trucking thing, then you can join with one of those agencies, right? Then you have the option to do something, right? And we're making it easy by connecting you. But in some way, the conversation, what everybody else ain't doing, is a distraction and a disruption. Right. You want to do the work? Let me help you get connected. And actually, that's not my responsibility to help you get connected. It's actually your responsibility, and it's really a human ethical imperative. Right? It is a good question because I know it comes up. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Where?
Yes, because we have guests watching a streaming, a live streaming event, and we want to make sure they can participate fully in the conversation.
Awesome. My question is, where's the wisdom in recognizing harassment, particularly by the police, and calling it out, if that makes sense? So, like, if I feel or if anyone feels that they're being harassed, where's the wisdom in saying something to the cop? You know what I mean? Mm. Like, I don't mind going to jail, but, like, I don't know if that's the proper way to turn the tables, so to speak.
Right. So you have to be, to borrow from Jesus, innocent as a dove and wise as a serpent. There is a time and place in which, depending on how you respond to that police officer, and honestly, maybe if you do nothing to that police officer, you may still wind up dead. I mean, the reality for how black children, largely black sons, but to some degree black daughters are also raised is a posture of submissiveness towards the police and cooperation to lessen the incidences of violence. We know that doesn't necessarily work. But you have to make that call, just like a woman who's a victim of sexual assault. You have to decide whether it is worth it to you to fight in that moment, and nobody can judge you for the choice you make. The truth is you, if you jump bad with some cops, you're going down, right? Black or Latino, male or female. It's also the case that sometimes asserting your rights forcefully is something you can walk away from. I mean, I honestly, because the stakes are so high and so lethal, I can't tell you. Some of y'all who know are on my Facebook page know I had an encounter with a cop after I got here. Right. I did jump bad, all in his face, right? And I knew I was lucky I drove away from that. And I was really clear going into that I might not drive away from that. Wow. But I was just at that point. But I can't commend that to anybody else, right?
Absolutely.
I really can't.
Thank you.
I have a question for you, Dr. Gaffney. So you talked about divinizing, the importance of divinizing black bodies. So sort of two layers to the question. The first is, why is the body theologically important? You know, within Christianity, we encounter the problem of sort of Platonic dualisms of the spirit over the body, mind, you know, over matter. And then on top of that, you have the extra layer of the ways in which racialized bodies have been denigrated as a matter of scripture itself. And so when you talk about the body, maybe if you could sort of address those two points, but then ultimately, why is the body theologically important?
Right. So I'm going to shift the language back to the way I articulated in the talk, which is not divinizing, which would be an ongoing process, but recognizing the divinity that is already present, right? Mm. The body is inherently theological, as is everything in the natural world, from the perspective of Jewish and Christian scriptures, which says that they are created by God, right? Mm-hmm. In a secular humanist discourse, that response may not function, but we're doing this work from the church and from a community of faith, and so that's the language that I'm using. So the body is theological because it is created by God. It is divine because it is created in the image of God, animated by the Spirit of God, and those things make the body divine because it is in our bodies that God is active in the world. And from a particular Christian point of view, the body is sanctified because that is the way that God chooses to enter into the world, God's self. That is the scandal of the incarnation. To borrow from Cornel West, the scandal is that God comes into the world through the spread legs of a woman emerging somewhere between urine and feces, in the center of sexual pleasure. The body is inherently theological in that discourse.
Dr. Gaffney, I really I wrote down what you said about how in the church we often treat people of color as children of a lesser God, that we have to get to the root. There's often a theological root to this disdain for black and brown bodies. And I was wondering if you could give some specific examples, because I know that's a claim.
Absolutely.
I find that convincing, but people may say, oh, I don't see that. Could you give us some specific examples?
People don't see it because they choose not to see it. Some of the ways in which black and brown people are marginalized in congregational discourse, I'm going to talk about Christianity here, is in the images of the saints and holy people in the sanctuary, is in the images of the saints and holy people in children's literature. You're teaching children that the beloved people of God are often people who do not look like them if they're black or brown. And for me, as an Episcopalian, where the sacrament of Eucharist is the central sacrament in my experience, when I'm in charge, the body of Christ that I elevate and I say to the people, this is the body of Christ, is not a white body. I always have black or brown bread. Every week in many churches, people are holding up something whiter than the walls and saying, this is Christ. Now, some of you, that's not your theology, that the implements are the body of Christ. But for those of us in those Catholic traditions, right, and I'm talking about Catholic, Orthodox, Anglican, and Episcopalian, who make up the bulk of Christians on this planet, well over a billion, we are holding up a physical object that through the mystery of our faith becomes a body of Christ, and it is often inscribed with whiteness, right? So the icons, the visible icons of our faith are white. The music that is acceptable in the larger service, for some of us that's a 10 o'clock, 10:30, 10:45 service, that service often reifies the European classical music norms. Black music, black cultural music is always extra, extra spicy, if it's even there at all. The entirety of our worship and our liturgy, for those of us who are in lectionary-based churches, look at the list of folk who put together the lectionaries. The African-American churches were excluded from that. So the whole notion of what the Christian year is, what stories are important, marginalized women, it's been revised to throw in, you know, a couple more women, they should be happy now. But it completely marginalizes ethnic and intercultural difference in relationship in the text, in, because that's not important to those white denominations that are responsible for the lectionary that tells many priests, pastors and preachers, teaching elders, what to teach and preach on. So it's as visible as who and or what is hanging on your wall, but folk are just not looking and they're not thinking.
Dr. Gaffney, I really appreciate your comments. My name is Chris Thomas, and I'm from the Episcopal Church of the Transfiguration in Dallas. Mm-hmm. And I think that our congregation, while it's certainly one of wealth and resource and primarily Caucasian, they would say that they are a congregation that stands with those disenfranchised people. I think it's interesting, though, because I think there's a conscious level of that, and then there's a subconscious level. And it doesn't move from conscious to that subconscious level until you've been the one who the police officer is harassing. Mm-hmm. And so it's hard for people to, they'll say, yeah, I want to get on board with that, I want to do this, I want to do that. But then they sort of get into the sort of anesthesia of their own life, you know, just driving carpool or doing whatever they do. And so until they've been confronted with something like this themselves, it's hard to, you know, so I'm going to be interested to find out, maybe we'll be talking more about that later, what are the steps to draw people into that conversation in ways that they can hear?
And sure. I think it's a poverty of Christian affection to be unable to empathize with someone unless it happens to you in your house and in your home. And so that's still that notion that black folk are fundamentally different, because we just can't empathize with that experience because it's not ours. Now, the community is sort of forming a crossover community is white mothers of black sons, right? Particularly after the execution of Darren Hunt, right? So there are white families that realize that all the privileges that they have bestowed on their children don't matter at all because they're walking in the world with black skin and they're being treated like everyone else. And so there's a small group of white folk who are energizing it from that particular perspective for whom it's critical because some of their sons have already died and others realize they're in peril. But for those who can't find a way in until it touches them personally, that's making my point because it is just, this is somebody else's issue. And that is the problem. It's the symptom and the problem.
Thank you, Dr. Gaffney. My name is Andre Gardner, former student here at Brite. I have a question probably like in maybe the last, I would say month or so, I probably had at least 12 or 13 different conversations with, I call them, and for lack of a better phrase, because I don't have any other name to call them, I don't know if they've been, but these kind of internet intellectuals. And so what's happening is that there's this kind of level of consciousness that's happening, I think, in the black community, where there's a pushback to the orthodoxy of church. Mm. And but it is primarily set forth on black people who are still in church, mm-hmm. supporting a church, specifically what you're talking about, kind of a Euro God. Mm-hmm. And so how do we start to have those conversations that, look, this is not a monolithic thinking. Mm-hmm. How do we start to have these conversations, or how do we even frame these conversations with people? I think that, I mean, the underbelly or the underpinning of this is that there are people who are leaving the church in droves because, I mean, there's like, I see at least maybe 12 or different memes every day of you're supporting a white God and how could Jesus be real if this is that and this is that. But it's becoming more and more frequent. So how do we start to have those conversations about, like, the church is addressing these things. From that perspective.
Sure. Well, the critique of a Eurocentric Christianity is a useful critique, and it's an old critique. It's, you know, Malcolm made that critique. The critique has been made before that. In terms of Christianity, I think it's, before we call them memes, a sort of retort I learned a long time ago, is that if somebody breaks out the windows of your car with a baseball bat, you don't throw out the bat, right? So Christianity has absolutely been used for evil for black and brown folk. That's without a doubt. The question that some of us have come to is that the evil is not inherently in Christianity. Other folk have not come to that, and that's fine for them. But if we're talking about doing the work of justice, then we need partners, and we can't limit our partnerships to those who only have our same view. So we ought to be able to work with the churched and the unchurched, the Christians, the Muslims, the NOI, the FOI, whoever is willing to be out on that front. And if you are so busy trying to take down somebody else's belief structure that you can't combat the violence that's happening out there in the streets, I question whether you're even down for the struggle, right?
Yeah, specifically, that's not what I was saying. Specifically, is that like, I'm okay with working with them, they're not okay with working with me.
Right.
I think that's what I didn't say.
Yeah.
Is that specifically this kind of conversation centers around that you can't really be a part of what we got going on here at this movement specifically because of where you stand on that basis.
Right.
So I'm okay with working with anybody.
Sure. I would say if that were my situation, I would let my work speak for myself. I would work with those who are willing to work with me. I'm not gonna worry about them, bless them. There's lots of room in this struggle. Let them do their piece. Right. Let them do their thing. You working on this, and I'm gonna work on this. Because there's some people you're not gonna be able to have that conversation with. I think that's unfortunate. I think it's small-minded, but that's I wash my hands, shake that dust, and move right on.
And Dr. Galfi. Dr. Alfie Wines, I graduated here at Brite in 2011. I pastored Dido United Methodist Church. I've been a United Methodist pastor now about 12 years. I have pastored black churches, and I currently pastor what is now known as a white church. And I just want to kind of enter into this conversation here about the Eurocentricity of Christianity. And one of the things that I like to do is remind people, where does the scripture come from? It does not come from Europe. It does not come from white people, but it comes from Africa and it comes from Asia. And that kind of changes a whole lot of stuff when we tell people that.
That's right. Christian's the only student I see right now in my class. You know, first day of class, where is biblical Israel? And What do we say every time that comes up?
North Africa, Asia.
And West, right. You know, Israel and Palestine are the land bridge between North Africa and West Asia, period. Biblical Hebrew, modern Hebrew, Arabic are Afro-Asiatic languages. Those are the scholarly classifications. That's it, period. End of sentence, right. But one of the problems is that folk have not taught that way. And so really, if you want to talk about subverting knowledge and creating new paradigms, yeah, it begins in the classroom. It matters that folk have not heard what the map says is obvious until a person who wears Africa on her skin gets in the classroom and says, by the way, you know, Hebrew Bible, Old Testament is not a European construct, right? So it matters who your churches hire, and it matters who educates your pastor. So some of this trickles all the way out through our society in a variety of different ways.
Dr. Gaffney, the artwork that we have on the second floor of this building is really beautiful, and I think it gives another picture of recognizing the theological significance of black bodies. I'm curious how you see the church using art, specifically these white churches. How can we use art to deconstruct white privilege in our churches today, so where Jesus is not the Red River vacationer in Kenneth Wyatt's disciple series?
Right. So there are a couple levels of this. One, that the reality is that most churches already have a set of windows, wall hangings, and stuff like that. And the windows are particularly pernicious. They're not going anywhere. Somebody's great-grandmother bought that window because her husband died, and you know that family still, you know, you really can't take the windows out of the church. I mean, so that means, one, you have to accept the fact that the imagery is already going to be stacked in many worship spaces, and you've inherited that. But it's important to call people's attention to them and visually and verbally deconstruct them regularly, right? Because when you let them sit there silently, they're testifying every week. And then depending on what the layout of your church is, it might be that you hang another series of black and brown images on the walls between the windows, depending on what that looks like. And if you use drop-down technology, then all of your stuff is countering that narrative, but you also address it explicitly, right? So that it's clear, why is this like this, right? And it's not even that you can't have these images. And if you're at a place where you're replacing windows or doing something different, then you look at that. I was in a space where the images were all white, and then we had this conversation, and the community decided to do some wall hangings, and they decided, well, we're gonna make our wall hangings, you know, race neutral. So they had, you know, praying hands that were blue and green, non-human colors. I said, so wait, what you're doing is you're leaving the only images that actually look like people, look like your people, and there's still none of my people on the wall. You haven't made any progress. And of course, they went on and did that and patted themselves on the back because they were good liberal white folk, right? So engage it, deconstruct it intentionally, verbally. I was in that space, and I don't even remember what I was preaching, but I went over next to that wall, and I just, you know, and I just stood right there, and I'm like, and everything that was wrong with Jesus right there, I just, you know, we just did that, right? So, yeah, just get out the pulpit, go over the window, and you know, preach against that window.
How did that sound like?
Paul, but Michael.
Oh, it was a good sermon. You know, some of them were mad. Some of them said something to me. Some of them didn't. Others really appreciated. There is an expression that some of my ancestors have used, good white folk, which has a couple of intonations. In the best intonation, the good white folk appreciated. I'll never forget when I was serving this particular parish in Hawaii that I'm affiliated with, when I first said, who bakes the bread? Because if I'm saying Eucharist, we need, the body of Christ needs to be the same color I am. My good brother like slammed on the brakes and pulled. He's like, I never thought about that. Like it had never occurred to him. It didn't have to occur to him because everything in that setup matched him, even though we were in Hawaii where the people are brown. right.
Dr. Gaffney, my name is Michael. I'm a student here. I was trying to write down so much of what you said, and you mentioned a thin veneer of respectability covering a framework of white supremacy. Mm-hmm. And then you asked this question, are black Americans even perceived of as citizens? And so I thought what the veneer of respectability is covering is a sort of false perception of what a citizen is. My question is, do you think that perception of citizen is fixed in whiteness, maleness, straightness, or is it more malleable? Does it adapt?
I think it originates in whiteness and maleness and straightness. I think it's being shifted, but it reverts to that default. I don't know if how many of you remember in, I'm going to say it's the second Gulf War, there was the story of this young woman who captured America, Private Jessica, and she had gotten captured, and they went and they rescued her. Well, when she was captured, there was a African-American woman captured, and they were led to her, and they were like, there's an American here. They looked at her and left her because she was brown. They did not accept her as an American. She was giving them her name and her rank and her serial number, identifying her unit. She had to convince them that she was an American. But they looked at white-skinned Jessica and picked that baby up and carried her home, right? Their default setting was, you are not one of us. Even though you're speaking really good English with an Atlanta accent in Iraq, you ain't one of us, right? So that default is hard to overcome. And when you see these encounters between police and black and brown folk, where from jump people are treated inhumanly. That default is deep. I believe, as I said, that it can be changed because of what I believe about God and what I believe about the scriptures. But it's a whole lot of work to get there. So I do believe it can be changed. But I have no doubt that that fundamental disdain for black bodies is deeply rooted in the white American psyche. It's there, folk gotta come to terms with it, and maybe to borrow some language from Dr. Day's religious tradition, need to call that thing out, exercise that, right? It's demonic.
Thank you, Dr. Gaffney. Wow. I just want to make a note to those that are watching live stream. If you go on to Twitter, Brite Divinity School, you can post a question, because at the end of Dr. Haynes' session, we are also going to take questions from those who are watching over live stream that can be directed to both Dr. Gaffney and Dr. Haynes. But right now, we're going to take a 5-minute break. And when we come back, we will turn our attention to the second presenter.
Lauren, drop me.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay.
I didn't realize you were still off.
Yeah.
Listening. I think I'm holding the mic camera. I see. They can hear, but they can't really see.
Yeah, exactly. They can't see your facial expressions.
Thank you.
to say stitches.
All right. Okay, well, he's sitting behind, so I just...
Okay. Now I'm going to introduce you first.
Okay. All right.
Oh, you know what? We are going to come back together, so we ask that everyone finish up their conversations and take their seats. Particularly the Brite faculty members. Causing all the trouble. Our hearts were stirred by Dr. Gaffney's presentation, were they not? We now turn our attention to Reverend Dr. Frederick Haynes, senior pastor at Friendship West Baptist Church in Dallas, Texas, right here, our very own. And a bit about Dr. Haynes. To begin, Dr. Haynes is not a stranger to Brite Divinity School. He has come in the past to preach, to lead in community conversations. He is known not only as a pastor, but as an activist, as an intellectual, as an advocator for those who are rendered voiceless within our society. But most importantly, one of the reasons why we wanted him to come here today is because he has a long track record of addressing forms of racialized violence, both within congregational settings, but also at the public policy level. And I think that's what's important, and part of what this teach-in, I mean, part of our conversation thus far, is we talk about the interpersonal, but also we're talking about the structural and the systemic found at the policy level. So I wanted to say a few things about Dr. Haynes. He serves in various leadership capacities. There is no way I can read his biography. We would be here for a good week. So I just want to highlight some of the amazing things that he does and continues to do as a way to champion social change, education, social transformation, justice. He serves, as I said, as a chairman of the board of the Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference, of which I am very pleased that Brite Divinity School, we've been sending a delegation of students each year to the Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference, and I would advise anyone in here to get to know this conference a bit better. He also is on the board of the Conference of National Black Churches and the National Action Network. And in addition, he serves as a member of the Board of Trustees of Paul Quinn College in Dallas, Texas, where he has also served as an adjunct professor. What I appreciate about his ministry is that he is indeed committed to connecting mind and heart, intellect to action, and it's greatly appreciated. Another thing that I will mention in terms of his awards is he has been named in Ebony as a part of the Power 100 list of most influential African Americans in 2012. He has been inducted into the National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame. Dr. Haynes was honored to give remarks at the memorial service of one of the most respected world leaders of the 20th and 21st centuries, that was President Nelson Mandela. And this was a privilege because it was the same sanctuary that the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. gave his very last sermon, the Washington National Cathedral. Something in addition that he is also known as sort of a national as well as a local hero is for much of the work that he has done surrounding payday loan companies and industries. Exactly, that does deserve a round of applause. and the disproportionate impact that it has on brown and black communities of color. And what I think is extremely important for this presentation is that right now he is galvanizing and mobilizing a movement, not only surrounding Ferguson through the Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference, but also through his local ministry at Friendship West Baptist Church related to Forney, Texas, where Kametra Barber, a mother, African-American mother, that was held at gunpoint by a policeman. And so I think in coming here that certainly he has a number of tools and insights to give us as it relates not only to concepts and ideas related to scripture and preaching, but also as it relates to the very important activism that he continues to do. We welcome you, Dr. Reverend Frederick Haynes.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Let me express my appreciation, first of all, to you here at Brite Divinity School for making me feel that there is a theological safe space and a home for someone that has the kind of ministry that I aspire to have. To have this kind of space in the Dallas-Fort Worth metroplex in the state of Texas borders on the miraculous. And so thank you so much for being who you are and for doing what you do. It says so much about you that you have on your faculty here, geniuses, prophetic geniuses, like Dr. Carrie Day and Dr. Will Gaffney. You are forming, from my perspective, a theological all-star team right here at Brite Divinity School. And so I want to salute you for doing that, because you are creating and facilitating a new generation of prophetic ministry that I believe will usher this nation, yes, even this world, into a new era where liberty and justice for all is not just a cute phrase, but a lived reality. So thank you so much for your work. Thank you so much for your theological and prophetic witness. Now, I hope that you feel sorry for me, because anyone who has to follow a genius like Dr. Will Gaffney, there's only really one thing to do, and that is, in the church tradition, pronounce the benediction, if not, take up an offering. And so I am equipped to do that and would be happy to, but I first must call into question my relationship with Dr. Carrie Day, who up until today I had concluded that we were friends and that there was a special relationship that we have. That does not exist anymore. And so I hope that you all will pray for her, that God will forgive her for putting her friend, her ex-friend, behind Dr. Will Gaffney. Now, let me say this. I am hoping and praying, and Dr. Gaffney, you'll discover I'm kind of unorthodox like this, and so speaking to you in front of you in an unorthodox fashion is going to be a trip. On the third Sunday in, this is a commercial, third Sunday in October, there will be an amazing preacher preaching at Friendship West Baptist Church. The month of October, we're designating Jesus and justice. That's our theme. And the third Sunday in October at the 10:45 hour, Dr. Carrie Day will be our guest preacher in that worship experience. And so we're excited about that. We do not have a preacher for the 8 o'clock hour. And so I would just really like for us to have a preacher at the 8 o'clock hour that day. We don't have one yet, but I'm looking at who I would like to invite for the third Sunday in October at the 8 o'clock hour. That will be Brite Divinity School Day at Friendship West. And so that's a good thing. I told you I'm unorthodox like that. So so on the third Sunday in October, it's going down like four flat tires. So I am excited about that. Dr. Day.
If Dr. Day comes to hear me preach it,
8 o'clock.
It's
on and popping. I love that. I love that. I love that. Okay, cool in the gang. Cool in the gang. So we serve a great God, and I really,
really like that. Now, those of you who have heard me know that I normally speak without notes, but in this setting, I want to do what I don't normally do. So I'm going to attempt to share this presentation with you. I've got to acknowledge our Minister of Justice. When someone speaks of what we do at Friendship West, I'm often given the credit as the face for it. Our Minister of Justice is a student here at Brite, Minister Danielle Ayers, and she is doing an amazing work, and I just wanted to appreciatively acknowledge her for who she is and for what she does. In light of the theme under which we have gathered, I want to use as a sub-theme, headlights or taillights, as we look at examining strategies for a Christian response to racialized violence. A jailed Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., which continues to prophetically indict the criminal justice system in America as criminal and unjust, responded to an open letter from eight prominent liberal white clergymen with his moving missive letter from Birmingham Jail. You find this letter from Birmingham Jail in his wonderful work, Why We Can't Wait. These well-intentioned Christian clergymen had criticized Dr. King and the Birmingham movement for stirring up trouble, labeling them outside agitators. The irony of Dr. King, Martin Luther King Jr., who a year later would receive the Nobel Peace Prize, being in jail for strategically organizing for justice so that America could make good on the promissory note of the Constitution and Declaration of Independence is still sad and startling. When he received this piercing critique from Christian clergymen, it stung. However, Dr. King incarnated the profundity of the picturesque poem which declared, two men peered out from prison bars. One saw mud, the other saw stars. He sees the stars of a prophetic and theological opportunity to frame the response to racialized violence rooted in white supremacy and manifest in structural injustice in terms of Christian discipleship. Dr. King, in the midst of this luminous letter, lovingly castigates the church for too often being the taillights as opposed to the headlights of society. In this presentation, I will be remixing and lifting lessons from the letter from Birmingham Jail. While illuminating this metaphor of taillights and headlights, Dr. King insightfully and brilliantly shed light on the darkness of racialized violence while prophetically denouncing the irrelevance of the church in the ongoing struggle for human and civil rights. The darkness of racialized violence and the absence and or irrelevance of the Christian church tragically remains problematic in 2014. From Ferguson, Missouri, to Forney, Texas, New York to New Orleans, California to Connecticut, Detroit to Dallas, Washington State to Washington, D.C., Sanford, Florida to San Francisco, California, the darkness of racialized violence and the taillight response of the Christian church remain sadly problematic. In Johnny Cochran's book, Journey to Justice, he testifies of visiting Geronimo Pratt. Geronimo Pratt, a Black Panther, had been imprisoned in San Quentin prison for a crime that he later was exonerated from. But Geronimo Pratt, before he sat down to consult with the legal mind, Johnny Cochran, said to Johnny, before we commence this conversation, I want you to see what's on my back. He stood up, turned around, and on the back of his prison yard outfit was a bullseye. He then testified, this bullseye is a reflection that when I am in the courtyard here at San Quentin, if I dare make one move to the right or left that a prison guard sees as inappropriate, they have been instructed to shoot to kill me. Why? Because he had a bullseye on his back. I want us to wrestle with that as a metaphor for what's going on in these yet-to-be United States of America, and suggest that maybe what the deal is with black bodies is that there is a bullseye on our back. From 2006 to 2012, according to Dr. Melissa Harris Perry, black men were killed by white police officers 2 times per week. Bullseye on the back. Every 28 hours, a black person is shot by some kind of law enforcement officer. Bullseye on our back. Racialized violence against black bodies forces black parents to invariably have the talk with their children about interacting with law enforcement, because there's a bullseye on our back. Kametra Doty McBride and her husband Chris had to expedite the talk with their children because on August the 9th, 2014, the same day that Michael Brown was killed in Ferguson, Kametra Doty McBride and 4 little kids were stopped in Forney, Texas. Jesse Jackson is right. There's a Ferguson near you. And while Kametra Doty Barber and her 4 children are riding home, two biological children, 2 godchildren, they are stopped by 4 police squad cars looking for a tan Toyota with 4 gun-toting black men. But they stop Mrs. Barber in her maroon Maxima with 4 kids between 6 and 10. I guess any black body will do when there's a bullseye on your back. Mrs. Barber and the children were terrorized by these officers as they handcuffed her and put guns to her head. A bullseye must have been on her back. Racialized violence is the experience of 8 black women in Oklahoma City who are accusing police officer Holtzclaw of rape. They have all been sexually violated and re-victimized by the absence of media coverage. An outrage that one in authoritative blue of a police uniform has abused his power and targeted black women for sexual violation. A bullseye must have been on their back or on their bodies. Where is the prophetic witness of the Christian church? Are we still guilty of being AWOL in the struggle for justice and human and civil rights? Are we content to shout in our sanctimonious cocoons of praise, listening to motivational messages that inspire us to beat the odds instead of challenging us to fight for justice and change the odds? Have we concluded, as one conservative cleric of a mega downtown church said just last week, that Jesus was not sent here to be a sanctified social worker? There are commercial advertisements that are catchy and clever, and we've seen them on television. But the scene portrayed in the commercial has nothing to do with the product being advertised. That's a trip. Is it true that the Christian church in America is now catchy and clever, but totally irrelevant to the social, economic, and political issues of the day? How sad it is that the church sanctioned slavery, stood silent and or supported Jane and Jim Crow segregation, apartheid in America, but has never led America in repenting for racial oppression and racialized violence or repairing the damage that has and continues to be done. The tragedy of Michael Brown and terrorism experienced by Mrs. Barber and her children challenge us to answer the call to be prophetic headlights that lead America out of the long night of racial oppression and racialized violence. Dr. King challenges us from his Birmingham jail cell with strategies for developing a Christian response to racialized violence. 1, we must be conscious of and confront the conditions that make racialized violence possible and prevalent and pernicious. In the moving and matchless missive to the ministers, Dr. King remarked how sad it was that the ministers denounced the protest in Birmingham, but they did not denounce the conditions that necessitated the protest. They did not repudiate the bombings of homes and churches in black communities. They did not denounce the barbaric brutality practiced by police in the abuse of black bodies, but they did denounce the protesters. Ain't that a trip? Is that not reflective of what we do even in 2014? We heard the denouncing, even from black preachers, of those who were rioting, quote unquote, and looting there in Ferguson. We heard one prominent prophetic preacher declare that this problem ain't about you. How dare you engage in acts of violence and looting? Hold on. Acts of violence and looting against injustice is as American as apple pie. Matter of fact, if you don't believe it, go back to the Boston Tea Party. An act of looting and violence in the name of rising up for liberty and fighting social and economic injustice. American as apple pie. But we denounce the looters, quote unquote. I was in Ferguson, so I ain't just talking it, I'm walking it. And while receiving a tour from one of the locals, they showed me something that blew my mind, and I pass it on to you. And that is, certain stores were hit and others were ignored. The ones that were hit were stores that had a track record of mistreating black bodies who were patronizing those stores. The stores that to this day are still standing tall, proud, unbothered, are stores that in a real sense have a track record of respectful service to the citizens of that area. I'm simply trying to let you know that we denounce the protesters, but we do not denounce the conditions. I won't forget when I had a car accident several years ago and I was engaged in a season of rehab. And the thing that blew my mind was that my wonderful rehab therapist at one point looked at me, said, "Stop what you're doing. I need you to walk." She said, "Stop." And then she said, "I see what your problem is. We're trying to fix the pain, but instead of dealing with what is causing the pain, I've been addressing your symptoms. That's what I do when I prescribe you a massage and pain medication. But what is wrong with you is that your structure has been altered by the accident that you went through, and so until we fix your structure, you're going to be in a state of pain." I park there parenthetically. Is that not a metaphor for what is happening in this country from Ferguson to Forney? And that is, there is something wrong with the structure of the body politic of America, and as a consequence, you have the pain that continues to exist and manifest itself. And so with that being the case, racialized violence is rooted in a denial, I love it, Dr. Will, of the humanity of black people. Racialized violence is ingrained in the structures of American injustice. It's stated in the Constitution, reinforced, watch it, in the Dred Scott decision. When I was in Ferguson, check this, I not only saw the memorial to my man Michael Brown, but I also saw just a few miles from that place where his body was left for 4.5 hours, emblematic of his being dehumanized, I saw also the space and place where Dred Scott, my dear sisters and brothers, in the 1850s was told by the Supreme Court of the United States that a black person does not have any rights a white person is duty bound to respect. I'm trying to let you know it's in the structure of this nation. The structure is off, and the structure is producing pain. It's illustrated, it's repeated over and over again. The over-militarized response of the state was to use the same weaponry and military might that is used to destroy foreign enemies. Have you thought about that? The same military weaponry that we use to fight enemies was used to keep the natives in place in Ferguson. The message of such a response is that blacks are subhuman enemies of this nation. James Forbes speaks of how, like fish in water, Americans are born into a context of race. And racism. Racism is the congenital defect in the body politic of America. George Kelsey said race for some actually functions as a faith perspective. Racial oppression can be intractable because it operates on the level of religious commitment. And so it can be said that race remains a problem in this country. Ferguson illustrates so much about racism's continue being a problem in this country. poverty rate, 22%. Even though the black population is over 2/3, African Americans have been relegated to powerlessness as whites maintain a power grip on the politics and economics of Ferguson. James Forbes said again, poverty is a weapon of mass destruction. White flight in Ferguson has carried with it quality education and economic opportunity, leaving behind economic deprivation, financial predators, and the arbitrary, abusive, and aggressive policing of a community in terror. There's a Ferguson near you. The wealth gap between whites and blacks in America is worse today than the wealth gap between blacks and whites during the height of apartheid in South Africa. There's a Ferguson near you. Number two, we must have a liberating theology that heals our poisoned psychology and transforms our sociology. Sadly, God has been misused in order to justify the abuse of those who are othered and defined as deficient because they are different, to use the language of Jeremiah Wright Jr. Dr. William Augustus Jones, in his book, God in the Ghetto, declared that our twisted theology has produced an evil anthropology and an unjust sociology. Check it. Bull Connor could teach Sunday school on Sundays in Birmingham, and then on Monday unleash dogs and fire hoses on black bodies marching for freedom. Dr. King is thrown in jail, arrested by this same Sunday school teaching Bull Connor. Dr. King and Bull Connor, I suggest, don't worship the same God. The misuse of God led William R. Jones in the 60s to shake up theological circles and ask, is God a white racist? As he surveyed the oppression and exploitation of black bodies the world over, he raised that question. Today, I'm going to remix it for you. Here's my title. Is God a white, patriarchal, homophobic racist who despises black bodies and any non-white males God created? Interestingly, the Bible rescues us and gives us a theological framework for strategically responding to racialized violence. Moses is tapped as the next leader of the liberation struggle for the Egyptians when he responds to racialized violence when an overseer is beating a Hebrew in spite of his privilege from being raised in Pharaoh's palace. He identifies with the underdog. Yes, Will Gaffney, he has an empathy beyond his privilege. And because he has that, Deacon Stephen insightfully in Acts 7 gives us the hermeneutic and says that Moses thought his own people would realize that God was using him to liberate them from oppression, but they missed it. Theologically, Stephen is saying that Moses saw God using him to deliver the Israelites as he responded and rescued them from racialized violence, but they missed it. Jesus is lynched as strange fruit on Calvary. Crucifixion was racialized violence. It was a message sent to all would-be revolutionaries. If you rise up against Roman oppression and occupation, this would be your lot. But when he's resurrected on Resurrection Sunday, it's an insurrection against racialized violence. And so Peter, watch it, gives the hermeneutic. He preaches in Acts 3 to a gathering crowd how he had been used to heal the lame man and says, you killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. The resurrection is an insurrection against racialized violence and injustice. So from the righteous anger of Moses to the insurrection of the resurrected Messiah, we see God speaking against racialized violence. Let's re-examine our theology. Finally, in order to end the nightmare, we must remix and rehearse the redemptive tragedy of the prophetic dreamer. Dr. King informed the ministers that whenever SCLC engaged in a movement for social justice, they went through four steps. Steps involved collection of the facts in order to determine whether injustices are alive. Number two, negotiate with the power structure. Number three, self-purification. Number four, direct action. It is vital that we do the same. If we want to address, confront racialized violence and injustice in this nation, it is vital that we collect the facts and see that racialized violence is a reality in this nation. We must also move from the facts to examining the root causes. After investigating the facts, we must attempt to communicate and negotiate with the responsible parties with a view toward bringing healing and reconciliation through justice. If that falls through, Dr. King recommends, after that, self-purification. This is profound. He was referring to ensuring that all involved were baptized in truth, committed to nonviolence, determined to fight for racial justice, even to the point of putting their lives on the line. If you haven't found something worth dying for, you ain't fit to live. Finally, they would hit the streets and engage in social action. They would put their bodies on the line. How does that look today? We must call for all police departments to go through racial profiling and sensitivity training. Last week, I was in Atlanta, Georgia, preaching. I was picked up by one who is about to run for sheriff of DeKalb County. And this dear brother, whose last name is Rambo, shared with me that he has been traveling the country, teaching police departments about the history of policing in this nation. The history of policing never was intended to protect and serve black bodies. As a matter of fact, it came as the result and it came as a response to keeping in place those black bodies that were shackled by slavery in this country. But daring to rise up in the form of Reverend Denmark Vesey, Reverend Gabriel Prosser, and the Moses of our people, Harriet Tubman. He went on to share that police forces rose up in order to serve and protect white bodies, watch this, while keeping in place black bodies. And with that being the case, it's in the DNA, it's in the very fabric of policing to this day. The very system of policing is still rooted in that kind of oppressive approach to dealing with black and brown bodies. And with that being the case, to contradict what has been said by some, when we look at policing today, no, it's not found. Bad policing is not the result of a few bad apples. No, if anything, you have a few good apples, but you have a system that is sick, a system that is oppressive. And until we as a nation ensure that all police officers, present and future, go through a season where they understand the history of policing and come to understand what racial profiling and injustice looks like, until that takes place, we are kidding ourselves. We must root out the cause of racial injustice instead of just saying you have a few bad apples here and a few bad apples there. It is systemic, and America must wake up and recognize that, or we will find ourselves continuing this process. We'll be back here again in days to come. After all, it has to be systemic. When you check it out, it goes from San Francisco to Sanford, Florida. If it goes from California to Connecticut, from Washington State to Washington, D.C., that ain't bad apples. I'm talking about a system that needs to be fixed, a system that needs to be confronted. And so we begin, don't miss this, we begin with checking the facts and discovering, discerning where the racial injustice is, and then going to the root of it and radically extracting that which is problematic for this nation. And so, my brothers and sisters, it begins, of course, with checking that out. But after we do that, we must demand that we must fight for and declare a full-scale war on poverty. We must finally educate and expose this nation, community by community, church by church, school by school, about the legacy of racial injustice and racialized violence and what it looks like today, and dare to create the beloved community. When this happens, justice will roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, and we shall overcome.
Questions, comments? Paul, thank you.
Dr.
Dr. Haynes, thank you.
Thank you.
We have a criminal justice program on this campus.
Great.
And from what I hear you saying, an important place to start is in criminal justice programs across the country. I don't have any immediate ideas. You know, I teach in the Divinity School. But I think you've suggested one of the ways we could address these matters, because the good news, I think, is that there are people preparing for law enforcement on this campus and on other campuses.
Right.
Where there might, in fact, be an opening and where a Divinity School might be able to, through its dean, who sits with the deans of all of the schools of the university, that would be the woman here in the kind of yellow and black jacket, would carry that message to the Provost Council. But thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
I have a specific question about how people of faith might help congregations and leaders of congregations in particular transcend their fear of doing politics from the pulpit.
Right. Right. One of the sad things is that I think that precludes a number of people from involvement. And I would just say that, number one, it has to be rooted in our recognition that we have a prophetic responsibility to push for justice. I mean, that's biblical. It's just been, unfortunately, edited out of some Bibles. And so with that being the case, there are preachers who avoid dealing with issues of justice. And I think that's not only unfortunate, but it undermines what this country could become if we had a prophetic pulpit. I would also suggest that, so it requires a re-educating, a reorientation of what it means to be a preacher, and that is a part of our preaching responsibility. We are called to be prophetic. These motivational messages are cute and nice, but when it comes to addressing structures and inspiring and mobilizing congregations to prophetic witness, it leaves sadly so much to be desired. So I think, number one, we must understand our responsibility to be prophetic, and that we can be prophetic without being politically partisan. And that's the main thing. God has a yardstick of justice. And the question is, do we measure up to the yardstick of justice? And guess what? Republicans and Democrats all fail when it comes to measuring up to the yardstick of justice. And I think that we have to have that kind of prophetic courage. I mean, that's why for me, the greatest American ever produced is a preacher, Martin Luther King Jr., because his prophetic witness not only spoke truth to power and partnered with LBJ, but when LBJ's Vietnam War was seen as unjust, he literally became an enemy of LBJ, because his prophetic witness said that there's a measuring line of justice that we all have to find ourselves aspiring to. And I'm going to prophetically tell the truth no matter what. And I think that's the kind of witness that we have to have as a people of faith. I think it has to be taught in seminaries because, you know, and I say it unapologetically, you know, I went to another seminary here in Fort Worth, and I didn't know about y'all. I sure hate it. And that seminary, there was not one class whatsoever that dealt with issues of justice. Not a one. That there was nothing speaking of prophetic witness. Not a one. I got 92 hours behind me. 92 hours and not one class. Not even an hour of a class during the whole semester was the word justice mentioned in my 92 hours. But again, that same school, you know, if you're a woman, you can only do certain programs as it relates to their, curriculum. I'm sorry, I just
That's all right. Keep preaching. I was really struck by your connecting policing and the DNA and the pieces. And what's going through my mind, and I don't know as if I have this articulated very well, I'm struck with the way in which issues of class, race, prison systems, the fact that prisons are basically the warehouse for mentally ill who have no money and power to get out of it.
Right.
So I'm kind of playing with these things, and I know you've done some work with the payday loans.
Right.
So what are the next steps in that conversation that need to happen?
Okay. And I'm so glad you brought that up, and thank you, Dr. Day. The irony of Ferguson, what just broke my heart, and I'll just tell you what I saw, because I didn't see everything, but I'll tell you what I did see. I saw payday loan store after payday loan store after payday loan store, and not one bank. Wow. And I'm used to that.
Yeah.
I'm used to that. Because over in Dallas, in our community where we've been fighting, where there was a bank branch, there is now a payday loan store. That's a metaphor, a profound metaphor for the harsh reality as it relates to economic opportunity that goes on in certain communities that are targeted. I read somewhere, and I want to give credit, and I cannot think of who said this, but they were just talking about how, sadly, America has become a nation where economically, if you're rich, you get tax cuts. If you're poor, you get fees. And that's where we are. And so economically, there's a root there. And so as far as I'm concerned, next steps for payday loan, got Danielle Ayers right here. We have a responsibility to keep pushing in Austin to close the loophole that allows these payday loan operations and car title loan stores to exist as credit service organizations. Because the irony of it is that that's how they get away with doing what they do, because they say they are servicing desperate communities and giving them an opportunity to build their credit. It's a hot joke.
Wow.
It's an insult. And but the sad thing is we have not been able to get a lot of headway in the Texas House and Senate, because at least two of those who we have elected to serve are owners of payday loan stores. Mm-hmm. Right here in Texas. And so it's just a sad, sad reality that when the session begins to meet in January, we've got to be right there in Austin. We've got to be in Austin lobbying to close that loophole. We've got to expose I want to say hypocrisy, but that's a real strong word. So I'll say hypocrisy of you being elected, owning payday loan stores, and then getting to block any passage that will regulate what you do.
Isn't that another form of racialized violence, right?
Thank you. Brilliantly said.
Start naming these things
as racialized violence. Say it. Yeah, I love that. Thank you.
Mine is more of a statement. Thank you very much, by the way. I didn't expect to come here and hear you, and wow, very profound. I was back here taking notes. A lot of people hear your message and your push for stopping the payday loans, but I don't think people really understand the magnitude. And so I'm speaking from a very personal standpoint, a very close relative who is over the age of 65, who is elderly, who is on disability, went to one of the payday loan stores and got a payday loan for $350, which is 50% of her disability check. $350, and this was in February of 2014. As of the 1st of October 2014, she is still paying $87 a month to pay off a $350 loan that, now that you look at it, it's no longer a $350 loan. It has a $500 and something or other balance, and she is given $87 each month to pay off that loan. So I don't think people who aren't there or don't realize the magnitude of how outrageous the process is, because I was unaware, and I was simply blown away. I was simply blown away. So I just wanted to say that so that as people hear you standing there speaking about it, it's not, oh, they just took out a loan, they'll pay it back. They understand the magnitude of a $350 loan that over 7 months is not even close to being paid off and is taking an elderly person's disability and food from there,
right.
Taking their away their ability to comfortably live, whatever that was there.
Right, and 2 months ago, one of my senior members came to me, showed me her payday loan. The interest rate was at 780%, and they were about to put her in jail if she did not pay the loan. And I'm talking about a senior member on fixed income, and it's just, it's sinful. And until we call it that, you know, name it as demonic. And again, here she is in a community with limited economic opportunity as it is. But what she has is a payday loan store to go to. And I was almost, at first I was mad. I said, you in my church, how are you going to do this? And then it just hit me. I'm judging her choice unaware of her options. And a lot of times we judge choices people make and we're clueless about the options they have.
Dr. Haynes, many of us have spent our lifetimes in mainstream churches which have a rich history of running off pastors who dare to say anything prophetic.
Right.
What can you recommend for those of us who are members who would like to have some leadership from the pulpit? What can you recommend that we do to save our pastors and our churches and carry out our mission?
Yeah, I can't thank you enough for that, because, you know, my survival has been miraculous. I mean, I was put out of my church back in the 80s, and so I've been there a long time, huh? And so there is a price to be paid, but what I discovered is that the price was paid because it was a vocal minority that became enraged, mad at me, and stirred up the pot. Where there was a silent majority, I never heard from. Until, you know, I get a restraining order telling me I can't go to church Sunday. And so I think that it's very important that the silent majority starts to speak out and speak up and encourage the pastor and say, you know what, I really appreciate the fact that you hit on that issue, and I'd like to hear more of that, because in many instances, we just don't hear. One of the things, Dr. Will G, that jacks with me is on Sundays, sometimes I don't even like to get on Twitter, because even though I know people are going to be nice and retweet this and say I said this, one of the things I've discovered is my members, for the most part, are going to tweet all of the motivational, inspirational things I've said. But they will never tweet the stuff I say that speaks truth to power. And as one of my friends said about me, I don't care what I'm preaching about, I'm going to hit justice somewhere. If I'm talking about baptism, I'm going to find justice in that. Okay? But I know there's not much of an appetite for it. Okay? At least by way of what gets back to me. And so I just keep on pushing anyhow. And every now and then, outside of church, I'll hear people say, man, I sure appreciate what you're doing. But in the church, just keep us inspired.
Keep rhyming.
Keep rhyming and rapping. Yeah. Yeah.
Dr. Haynes, you talk a lot about the importance.
How are you going to ask me a question?
She's a bright student.
Yeah. And she going to answer. She's going to answer what she asked.
So you talk a lot about having a prophetic witness, but can you talk about the importance of having a prophetic imagination to go along with that, so that while we're fighting the structures, that we come up with alternatives or the structures we want to see? Maybe you can talk about the alternatives you have for payday loans.
Ain't that some stuff? My own minister of justice, I'm going to put her on probation. No, very seriously. And that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to prophetically imagine a new economic world. And so what we've done at the church, God has blessed us. We had a vision for a microloan fund, what we're now calling Liberty Loans. And I think many of you are familiar with the Nobel Peace Prize winner. I'm getting used to these braces. I might as well confess, okay? The Nobel Peace Prize winner from a few years back, who won the prize because of what he was doing by way of justice work over in India, giving microloans to poor people. And so what we're trying to do is say, okay, it's one thing to justice on the one hand says, yes, close the loophole that allows them to operate as a credit service organization, fight to bring down the interest rates that they get away with, but at the same time, create an alternative that shows the world this is what can be done so that those imprisoned by impoverishment can have the key to their own freedom. And as the Nobel Peace Prize winner shared, he discovered that the payback rate on those micro loans is greater than the payback rate of those banks that are giving money to big businesses. Interesting.
We know Donald Trump ain't paying nothing.
Come on now, ain't paying nothing back. And going bankrupt and covering himself like that.
Okay.
And you my member, and you're gonna ask a question.
Yeah, if I could pause you for 1 second, because okay, we have limited time, and I want to get some questions from people from online
that are trying
to post. But I'm going to get to you, I promise. This question is from Corey Weldon out of Chicago, Illinois. He was taken by poverty is a weapon of mass destruction. Mm. So his question is sort of twofold. Why is poverty not seen as an evil? It seems to me that many preachers preach and argue that the text says the poor will always be with you. What does this text mean? And really, and how can we respond to such logic?
Okay, and again, text out of context is a pretext that cons people. That's why I am so, so in love with the work of Dr. Will Gaffney, because she puts the text back in their original context and she argues with them. And I appreciate that so much. The poor you'll have with you always. What about, okay, you want to get into heaven, you got to have on your reference, you know, some poor folk. I was hungry, did you feed me? Thirsty, did you give me drink? And your response to that has everything to do. I mean, where you end up, sheep, goat, has everything to do with your response to the poor, with your response to those who have not. And so putting that in context, the emphasis of that passage, and y'all know this in this setting, so I don't want to even insult you, but the emphasis of that passage had nothing to do with Jesus justifying the continuation of poverty. In a real sense, Jesus was, in his own subversive, brilliant, prophetic way, denouncing the structures that continue to allow poverty to exist. And so to say the poor you have with you always as a justification for not fighting poverty is an insult, and it is, again, it does violence to the message of Jesus. It takes him out of his context, and as far as I'm concerned, Dr. Forbes is right. I wish that was my quote. Poverty is a weapon of mass destruction. James Baldwin, it costs a lot to be poor.
Yes. Wow. That's it.
And do you mind if Dr. Gaffney shares?
She's got to.
Excellent. Okay.
This is my preacher on the third Sunday at 8 o'clock.
give me a thumbs up, Lauren. Am I here? All right. It's also the case that Jesus is saying that we are not going to have some sort of socialist utopia where everyone's going to have exactly the same amount of stuff. That's not even realistic. There is always going to be a differential in the possessions that folk have, but there does not have to be that soul-crushing poverty under which some folk can't even feed their children. So within that system, yes, you have an opportunity to continue address it, but I think there's a way in which the hermeneutic is also, I know daggone good and well, y'all are not gonna do right on this issue. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think there's a piece of that that's fatalistic.
Yeah.
Wow. And could you stay there?
Yes.
Because I
yes,
just
ma'am.
Wanna get a couple of more online questions
okay,
before we get the final two questions. From Todd Bristow, Brooklyn, New York,
just moved here to Dallas. How does prayer relate to the transformation of racist structures? I am looking for holding as complementary and mutually inclusive spiritual disciplines alongside structural transformation.
So I think that there is a poverty of imagination, we used that word earlier, around what prayer is. Mm. And for people who understand prayer primarily to be words or thoughts, I think are missing the iceberg underneath the tip that show it. But prayer is also action, right? And so if you go in your room, in your closet, get on your knees and, you know, pray heaven down against racism, get up, leave your closet, never say anything to anyone, never name or work on dismantling the structures, then you're not really doing the work that prayer calls from. So I think we need to have a clear understanding that prayer is not just telling God what you think, hope, believe, or would like to be. That we pray with our bodies when we get up off our knees.
Yeah. I'm going to tell you what's amazing by way of going even back to Birmingham again and Dr. King. You recall the Birmingham movement was basically stalling and things were not going well. They were running out of bodies to go to jail. And Dr. King, Easter weekend is on the way. His daddy wants him to come back to Atlanta and preach. Dr. Daddy King, Dr. Benjamin Elijah Mays, and some other preachers gather in Dr. King's motel room, and when they gathered in his room, they raised the. Dr. King says, "Okay, I can go back to church, preach Easter Sunday, or I can go to jail and make a statement." And they're going back and forth with that. And Dr. King gets up, exits the living room area, goes into the bedroom. He says, "I've got to pray." When he came out, he came dressed in overalls. He had gone in to pray, came out dressed in overalls, and went to jail. And from that prayer, he goes to jail and writes the letter from Birmingham jail. So that's an illustration of the insight coming from Dr. G, and that is prayer will send you into a private space and then empower you for that public space.
And people want to shout. And another question. Another question. This is actually one of your ministers who could not be here. I'm just telling you, one of your ministers, Christina Bates, and she asks. There we go. I lost it. She asks. We often have diverse audience in settings such as this discussion, but should we not make an effort to unite together to call for and demand the U.S. Justice Department to do a broad investigation of the police departments across the nation who have had an excessive number of reports of injustice toward minorities? Or do we sit back as a nation and wait for the next Michael Brown murder, possibly after an investigation on a national level? So please, I know both of you can speak to this, but I know that you know at the Department of Justice some things that are transpiring.
Right. And let me just say this, several civil rights organizations and persons who are leaders have appealed to the Justice Department, the Department of Justice, to have, again, racial sensitivity training across the board to ensure that police departments engage in aggressive recruitment and retention of black and brown police officers across the board. I think that there need to be voices from the faith community that join in and send letters to the Department of Justice and say, we are on board. We want to go on record as saying every single police department in this nation, bar none, needs to have the kind of racial profiling and sensitivity training, because we've got to extract from the DNA of our policing efforts the over-surveillance, the over-policing of these black and brown communities, and it won't get done if we just act like it's a few bad apples.
Yes and yes. It's reactive and proactive. So yes, we react as a community, And if we don't have people of multiple ethnicities working with us, we do it anyway. And yes, we must do the proactive stuff because we'll never resolve it if we simply respond to each outburst. But we must respond to each outburst. So yes and yes, proactive and reactive.
One final question online, and then we'll conclude with the final two questions from our audience. This is from a Brite, someone that has graduated from Brite, very beloved, of course, she knows both of you, the Reverend Dr. Irie Lynn Session. She could not be here. She's out of town doing her own work, but she did send in a question. How can seminaries like Brite Divinity School better prepare and equip students, particularly white students, to become transformers of racist minds in their respective congregations and communities? So I hear this as a question of how does a seminary further enable white students to grapple in their congregations with the question of white privilege?
Okay. So I'm going to talk about this from the curriculum point of view. Each discipline has its own history of race and racism. And each person that stands in the classroom has to be clear about that, and that has to be up front and present. And we who are faculty colleagues have to call and hold each other to account. And so we have to ask, how does this course address the legacy of race in the Christian church and in America? And time out for courses don't do that. We can't skip that elephant in the room anymore and pretend that it's just furniture.
Amen.
As a recent Brite graduate, and my whole life was changed by the courses I had with Dr. Day, and I certainly think that, I don't know if it's required, but these courses should be required by everyone at Brite.
Good.
I also believe that prophets are not popular. They've never been popular, and that we have to really bring a prophetic voice. I have found that I am loved in my congregation, but I'm not liked very much. And you know what? That's okay. And I think we have to get over being liked in ministry because we have a lot of work to do out there. And that with our police departments and really these payday loans, this is systemic. These are systemic problems. And I would only say that we have an election coming up, and I can't really tell you who to vote for, but for governor, but I will say that the lady that's running is trying to get rid of those loans.
Well, I have no doubt that Dr. Day is a fabulous course, and a professor, it would be wonderful if her courses, all of her courses were required, but I also want to challenge my Melanin Challenge colleagues. It ought to be that students get reoriented to racist practice in white classes. It cannot be our responsibility as faculty of color.
Right.
Racism is a white folk problem, like patriarchy is a male folk problem.
Right.
We are going to do it because our lives are in peril, but it ought not be on us.
Yeah. That's right. Okay, my final statement. Obviously, I am a member of Friendship West. I wanted to say publicly that I thank you for everything that you do. It's not a question, it's more a thank you. And you have changed my paradigm. I've always been a social justice person, but you've changed my paradigm to make sure that I'm very active, continue to be active, and there's somebody that I can look up to make me push me a little bit further, number one. Number two, in reference to payday loans, not only does he preach very well, but he practices what he preaches. In our ministry, you're just doing the 10, 10, 20, 10% tithing, 10% saving, 80% to live on. I'm sure a myriad of people have done that. My paradigm is changing. I make a halfway decent living. I did the financial university. My mama paid for, but I didn't do all great. And thank you for the anointing that you had to have us come down. And with prayer, not only prayer, but there are some supplications in the ministry and the blessings that you will give on Wednesday. So thank you for practicing what you preach.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Let's show them some love. We really appreciate Dr. Gaffney, Reverend Dr. Gaffney, and Reverend Dr. Haynes. So a couple of notes before we conclude. I wanted to let everyone know that on the table outside in the lobby, you will see tons of Brite literature. But along with that, you will be able to pick up the Turning Tables teach-in resources. It includes a beginning reading list. I think it's very important, particularly as it relates to understanding the DNA in this country of racist culture. And I think part of what the discussion has been is that racism is just not discrete and something sort of over there at a personal level. It is cultural, it is systemic, it is structural. But then as well, how church communities can respond. And some of these texts focus on issues of white privilege, which I thought would be very important. The other thing to note is the top movements that support and are speaking out on Ferguson, Forney, and other forms of racialized violence. Please, get involved. There are a number of people that are leaders here, and you know, why reinvent the wheel? There are people that are doing this work, and so I would encourage you to collaborate. This information will be up on the Black Church Studies webpage. And the video that we've been live streaming will go up at www.brite.edu. Then I guess it's a / live stream. So again, it's www.brite.edu, / live stream. We can't thank you enough here at Brite for coming on today. A part of Brite's commitment is to be a theological educative center at the regional level and at the national level that challenges and attacks from a faith perspective anti-black practices, structural practices, and logic. So we can't thank you. We're going to conclude with Tomika Richardson, who is now pastoring her first church and will be graduating from Brite in December, to come up, and she's going to lead us in a litany. I believe you have, everyone should have that sheet, and we are going to go out together knowing that we are empowered to do the work of love and justice. Tomika.
Let us stand. A sound is heard in Ramah, the sound of bitter weeping. Rachel is weeping for her children. She refuses to be comforted, for they are dead.
We pray for the families of children who have
been slain by gun violence, led to die on the streets with less dignity than is given to animals. A sound is heard in every city. Communities are weeping generationally for their children. Our sons, like Emmett Till, Trayvon Martin, Ezel Ford, Michael Brown, John Crawford, our daughters like Ayanna Jones, Miriam Carey, Melissa Williams, and Tratika Wilson.
As people of God, we believe for the lives of all children who, instead of enjoying the sweet sound of the nation's song, have been slain by gun violence.
Now, let us rise up and interrupt these rushing waters of violence that leave children and communities wounded and paralyzed, traumatized by internal disintegration and state terror. Let us rise up and demand this nation abandon its affairs with beliefs, practices, and laws that are rooted in militarism, justified by racism, and propped up by systemic inequalities. O Lord, we commit ourselves to seeing all children the way that you see them. No matter their age or race, they are precious gifts made in your image, created with transformative purpose and unlimited promise. We embody the universal spirit of Ubuntu. I am the God of Abraham. We are all Rachel crying for the children. Therefore, we pledge to block arms in solidarity with the families of the slain. We pledge to let our voices be heard all over this nation and the world. For we know we are called to do what is just and right.
Please enjoy the light reception that we have in the back. And I also want to recognize some BCS board members, the Reverend Walter McDonald, the Reverend Carol Gibson, and Reverend Thompson. Thank you for all that you do for Brite. Please go in blessings and peace.